Mini chapter 109, Police Romance and the Apex Predator. The moment he wakes into the morning light on his sofa in the study, Jaymi feels the flicker of a new permutation of guilt in the question he asks himself. Has he been despotic towards Amber in sending him after the Dreary Ones like this, first to stalk and terrorize them, then to sabotage their venture down in Westmont, and now to terminate Kelly? The question nags at him. Wasn't the termination in particular a step too far? In the moment before she choked to death, Kelly was electrified by the darkness in Amber's eyes, by the forbidden quality in that darkness, by its authentic nihilism of sociopathy, body horror and madness. Has Jaymi warped Amber by equipping him with those things, by birthing him as an enforcer destined to wreak destruction? If so, that's hardly fair on him. Further, has allowing Amber to follow his nature pushed Jaymi himself beyond the pale of civilization at last? Well, yes, it has pushed him there. Of course it has. That, however, is the nature of war. Yes, war. Jaymi was shot at with three real bullets from a gun drone on his own bedroom terrace upstairs. If that didn't count as war, what on earth was it? Mere horseplay? A bit of rough and tumble? No, it was clearly war. So, did the Dreary Ones expect he wouldn't retaliate? Furthermore, Jaymi is certain that not just a ton of suffering, but actual deaths of random innocent people around the world will occur as a result of Ain't They Freakies streaming out globally. Or rather, they would have occurred had Jaymi not sent his beasts to repurpose the whole ghastly game. He jumps as his phone emits a loud ting. Thank goodness, it must be Amber texting him. He'll probably be wondering why Jaymi abandoned him as soon as Kelly died, not knowing, of course, that Jaymi had fallen asleep here without intending to. Oh well, not to worry too much about that. Amber's a big boy. He can always cope perfectly well without help or reassurance, for certain. But hold on, that wasn't the audio alert that signifies an incoming text. It was the alert allotted to his home security system. He grabs his phone with mounting apprehensiveness. The security app has opened, displaying the same image that has popped up on the CCTV monitor at the end of his desk. A car has driven right up to his front gates, triggering the app's alert. It's a police car. Jaymi jumps up, runs to the front of the house, and peers around the edge of a window on the landing. Sure enough, a black and white LAPD car. How could this have happened? Every common sense practicality was set up with precision ahead of time. Amber's use of an anonymous car with a fake number plate, Amber's texting with an untraceable phone card, the whole works. Jaymi isn't stupid, he brainstormed all of that stuff. So what could have gone wrong? A uniformed cop climbs out of the driver's seat, stands up, a big dangerous specimen for certain, and presses the button beside the gates. The buzzer sounds in the hallway downstairs, and a churning of vertiginous despair starts rushing up in Jaymi as he contemplates the ruin of his life through a murder or manslaughter conviction, if this carries on in the direction it appears to be going. His despair spreads wider. Never has he felt so low as he does now, behind all the external drama of this moment. Also behind the drama, buoyant alongside the despair is a little hoot of ironic mirth at how incongruous it is for a police car to be entering his life. Isn't this the kind of car that pops up in lives that are altogether different from his? He strides up and down his landing, at a loss to know what to do. What rage he feels, too, at his own impotence in the face of Bangdad's massive resources and the vast global amperage of appeal their crass newsfeeds will always command, beside the tiny amperage of appeal that his own much higher voltage content commands. What's been the point of his ever trying, if he's hardly even been able to dent the sheer inertia of Bangdad's heavy armour? On top of which, it now looks as if he'll rot in prison for murder, while the Dreary Ones continue to vomit up their newsfeeds around the world forever. What a vicious fuck-up! Tears starting in both eyes, he dashes back into his study, cursing in bitter incoherence. He streaks across the room to the CCTV monitor to look at a close-up of the cop, in case the man's expression should provide any intelligence regarding how best to open communications, and scuds to a halt in utter confusion. The cop has bent down close to the security lens beside the button outside the gates, so that his face fills this entire desktop monitor, fixing Jaymi with a piercingly perceptive fluidity of humour in a pair of wide-set eyes. It's Amber! Jamie's confusion is mixed with a surge of relief, then a burst of joy. He darts a finger onto the intercom button on the app. "Are you being followed?" he asks in a low voice. Amber gives a leisurely shake of his head. "No," he replies quietly. "After I was arrested, I pulled the radio off the dashboard and left it in Skid Row with the walkie-talkies and mobiles before I drove here."
"What? You were arrested? And I slept through it? For fuck's sake!"
Seeing Amber raise his finger to his lips on the screen, Jaymi speaks more softly. "Okay, first of all, let's get that cop car out of sight. Come in and drive straight into the garage." He presses command in the app, then watches the front gates and garage doors open while Amber returns to the driver's seat. With the gates reclosing behind him, Amber glides the vehicle ahead into a space in the triple garage whose doors Jaymi shuts again as soon as those LAPD insignia are hidden from the potential view of any distant nosy parker across the canyons. Entering the garage from inside the house, he sees Amber getting out of the car dressed in LAPD uniform. Jaymi is just about to speak, but stops when Amber brings his forefinger up to his lips in a forceful gesture bidding silence. In answer to Jamie's questioning expression, Amber points towards the locked car trunk. Jaymi leads Amber through the internal door from the garage into the house, then through the main hallway, through the little cinema, and across the sitting room to the doors of the ground floor terrace. He points to the uniform Amber is wearing. "Very flattering. Where's the cop who was wearing it?" "In the trunk of the cop car, naked, beside the other cop who's still in uniform, both alive and uninjured, but gagged, blindfolded, and tied up with rope." Jaymi grins. "Wow," he says, and stands there a moment, untangling these events in his mind. "Congratulations on extricating yourself." Then he taps Amber's chest several times. "Apex predator."
"I try," demurs Amber.
"So, now what the hell to do? He's in up to his neck here, and no mistake. There's a murder scene downtown, a stolen cop car, and two kidnapped cops. This big blonde beast here is dangerous company. I could assassinate the two cops to stop them giving out a physical description of me," says Amber. "Advanced publicity images have been going out for the Platinum Raven already. Either of the cops could have recognized me from those. If so, the LAPD will have an immediate connection from the perpetrator to that game's creator, one Mr. J. Peek." Jaymi winces. "I see your logic, but I can't have you kill them. That's just not right. Kelly was guilty as hell, but those two aren't. We need to find another way." Then he half smiles. "In any case, even if your appearance does remind the cops of some publicity image, they'll think it was just a coincidental resemblance. I mean, what else could it be, right? These are cops. They have a practical mindset." He rests his forehead on the palm of one hand, in a manner suggesting exhaustion infused with amusement, while Amber nods slowly with narrowed eyes, as if taking a new step over some threshold of self-understanding. "Did anyone else see you?"
"No, only Kelly."
Jaymi nods in thought. Then the hint of a breakthrough shines in his eyes. "You know, the cops won't be alone in that reaction. Nobody who worked on these games knows I have the ability to take the final step and actually incarnate you all. So no one will suspect I've done so, provided I put this incarnating business to rest for a good while. The only people who ever knew I could do it are the four Bangdad folks. Herb and Ashley, who've come over to our side. Kelly, who won't be saying much. And Dud," concludes Amber, fixing Jamie's eyes with a bland, blonde smile.
"Okay then, time for damage control."
As soon as the darkness of evening has fallen, the black and white cop car noses quietly back out through the front gates of the house on Electra Drive, with Amber in the driver's seat, changed out of LAPD uniform and wearing a different pair of leather gloves from those he donned on Factory Place. A minute later, before the front gates close, Jaymi drives out in his own car and follows at a distance. To avoid the myriad camera lenses and crowds of eyes that might witness his driving through traffic, Amber eschews Sunset Boulevard, thereby also eschewing the long ascent of Sunset Plaza Drive, up which Kelly once tailed him. Instead, he takes the cop car up Laurel Canyon rather than down it, so as to seep unnoticed across the Hollywood Hills, along the quiet length of Lookout Mountain Avenue, then Appian Way. By this backstreet route, he arrives at the very same hairpin bend where he once peered in at Kelly through her window and gave her a creepy, childlike wave using just the fingers of one hand. Right there, just above the inaccessible highest cul-de-sac of Blue Jay Way beneath him, he parks beside the crash barrier at the end of the hairpin, where no nearby windows can see him. He gets out, leans back into the cop car, uncovers the two squirming, rope-bound, gagged and blindfolded bodies on the back seat, and arranges them so that the uniformed cop is sitting upright and the naked cop is curled up on his lap with the unworn LAPD uniform on the seat beside them. Then he closes the cop car door, steps across to the passenger seat of Jaymi's car, which is pulled up beside him, and gets in. Jaymi's car rolls onward around the east face of the hairpin and gathered speed as it heads down Sunset Plaza Drive. His phone rings. "Hello," he answers. "Hi, it's Ashley. I still can't get over what an amazing show that was last night in the server farm." "Me neither. Plus, as you'll know better than anybody, Ain't They Freaky remains dead. They haven't started it back up again yet. Has Dud suspected you or Herb of any involvement in that? Or me, indeed?" "No. He's decided incompetence on my part must have contributed to a security lapse that wiped the game away, but he doesn't realise you were involved, and Herb and I are under no suspicion of any treacherous involvement, as yet. But I'm paranoid he may start to wonder, which is why I'm calling. I have a suggestion to help us appear as if this week were just business as usual, no different from other recent weeks. I know that gossipy freelancers have informed Dad you've created Scorpio, so I imagine he wouldn't be surprised if you sent Scorpio around to visit him and me to taunt us with your new creation, because that's exactly what you did after each of the other beasts was released. Okay, Dad may be too distracted to be thinking about that right now, but if you don't send Scorpio to see us, then in a few weeks' time, when the Ain't They Freaky fallout has subsided, he's quite suspicious enough to start wondering why you didn't, and whether anything significant had happened that made you forget to send Scorpio. Better if we stick with our pattern." "Good thinking, yes. Shall I tell Dud that I've heard on the grapevine you're about to inflict Scorpio on the Blue Jay Way house tomorrow, let's say? I know he'll be working from home tomorrow, not in Century City, and I have a couple of meetings at his place with him, either side of lunchtime." "Perfect. Thank you, Ashley. Brilliant thinking. Keep me updated on the timing of that. I'll be ready to send Scorpio up there whenever's best, as I did with the Platinum Raven. And when Scorpio shows up, can you try not to hurt him more than you have to for appearance's sake?" "Of course I shall, as far as possible." "Okay, I'll text you tomorrow morning when I know more."